Species Counterpoint in Two Parts, an Introduction. Our learning how to write a cantus firmus, similar to the one below, taught us to distinguish between conjunct and disjunct motion, consonant and dissonant melodic intervals, the distinctions between steps, skips, small leaps of a fourth, and large leaps of a fifth or more, also the differences between several modes. We learned that in a cantus firmus, certain melodic intervals are acceptable, major and minor seconds, thirds, also sixths, perfect fourths, also perfect fifths and octaves, whereas others are not, i.e. sevenths, also chromatic, diminished, augmented, and compound intervals. In order to combine together two independent melodic lines, a cantus firmus and a counterpoint, we begin with exercises in species counterpoint. This refers to the specific note values of the counterpoint, whether whole, half, or quarter notes, in relation to the cantus firmus. Yes, we are talking about rhythm. When a counterpoint in whole notes is matched to an existing cantus firmus, also in whole notes, whether above or below, it is called first species counterpoint, or note against note. Listen to this example from the famous treatise Gradus ad Parnassum by Johann Joseph Fuchs. To work out such an exercise, we consider not only the horizontal flow of the upper counterpoint, acceptable and unacceptable melodic intervals, but also the vertical, harmonic intervals between each pair of notes, upper and lower. Figures between the two parts mark the vertical intervals. In two-part first species, only consonant harmonic, i.e. vertical, intervals are allowed. Perfect unisons, fifths, octaves, major and minor thirds, sixths. Their compound versions are also permitted. Perfect twelfths, major and minor tenths, and thirteenths. Notice any missing? When there are only two parts, a vertical perfect fourth between cantus firmus and counterpoint is considered to be a dissonance. This is because a harmonic perfect fourth wants to resolve to a third. Dissonance between bass and an upper part is not permitted in first species counterpoint, hence no perfect fourths. By avoiding direct motion into a perfect interval, your singer or instrumentalist can improvise fill-ins between melodic skips or leaps in his written part and not create parallel or hidden perfect intervals, which are forbidden. So, direct motion into a perfect interval is not permitted. We may use direct motion, whether parallel or similar, only when proceeding into an imperfect interval, but may use contrary and oblique motion into any interval. Direct. Contrary. Oblique. However, be careful to not create parallel fifths, unisons, or octaves by contrary motion, as shown on the left. On the other hand, alternation by contrary motion between fifths and octaves, or unisons, is acceptable, as on the right. First species with upper counterpoint, lower cantus firmus. This is how we do it. The exercise may begin with either a perfect octave or fifth, which establishes the tonic or key, but not with a perfect fourth. Remember, when there are only two parts, perfect fourths are dissonances and not permitted in first species. Perfect ending. No imperfect interval is allowed on the end. No thirds. The cantus firmus and counterpoint must both end on the final or tonic note of the mode or key, which means no perfect fifth is permitted on the end either. An octave is okay. With the cantus in the lower part, there must be a major sixth in the next to the last, or penultimate, bar, cadencing on the final at the octave. In minor modes, but not Phrygian, the seventh scale degree is chromatically raised to create an artificial leading tone in the upper counterpoint. Here are soprano and alto staves, bar numbers above the soprano, and intervals figured between the cantus firmus on the bottom and the upper counterpoint. Note that perfect intervals tend to put the brakes on the flow, and octaves are worse than perfect fifths, whereas the thirds and sixths move along easily. Unisons must be avoided in two-part counterpoint, except at the beginning and end. A unison has the unfortunate effect of canceling out one voice. Listen. By the way, octaves in the middle section of an exercise, though not as bad as unisons, may be used, but sparingly. A tone may be repeated only once, not in the cantus firmus, but only in the counterpoint. In first species, this is, in fact, the only way to have oblique motion in the cantus firmus. Analysis. Remember to approach perfect octaves and fifths by contrary or oblique motion only, never directly. Neither parallel nor similar motion into a perfect interval is permitted. Based on the measurements of bars 1 and 2, we have oblique motion, marked with the letter O, from bar 2 to 3, parallel, marked P, bar 3 to 4, contrary, marked C, then similar motion between bars 4 and 5. The rest are marked on the slide as well. Let's listen. Summary of guidelines for writing two-part first species upper counterpoint to a cantus firmus. If it helps you, pause the clip and take a screenshot of the slide. You are, of course, encouraged to practice adding an upper counterpoint line to one or more of the cantus firmi you created in previous assignments. Post a question or a comment, and be sure to like, share, and subscribe for updates. Food for thought. Assignment. Transcribe this example to grand staff, then play the two parts together on a piano keyboard. Better, sing the cantus firmus part while playing the upper counterpoint line on the piano. Then the reverse. Play the lower cantus firmus part while singing the upper counterpoint. If necessary, transpose the keyboard part up or down an octave to suit your voice. You may also try singing the two parts together with a partner in solfège. Thank you for watching.